Moving sideways, the Fed holds rates near zero, tech looks for its mojo, and Washington, well, Washington just doesn't know what to do about stimulus. This is Bloomberg Wall Street Week. I'm David Westin. This week, two former Treasury Secretaries, Larry Summers of Harvard and Hank Paulson of the Paulson Institute.
This is a very serious challenge, much more significant than what we faced during the 2008 financial crisis.
Former Federal Reserve Governor Dan Tarullo, Sam Palmisano, who ran IBM.
Enterprise tech companies have a lot of experience in protecting data. They do this for themselves and for large enterprises. It's probably a better partner than, let's say, your traditional consumer tech company.
Katie Nixon of Northern Trust and Roger Altman of Evercore.
Without the Fed, we'd be in a bad place. And I'm not commenting on M&A, I'm talking about America.
It was a week full of news, but news sometimes lacking a real theme, with the Fed signaling it will hold rates near zero until sometime in 2023, but Chair Powell saying both that things were better than expected and that it was highly uncertain.
We expect to maintain an accommodative stance of monetary policy until these outcomes, including maximum employment, are achieved.
High-flying tech stocks continue to come back toward Earth, but a brand new cloud software company went public and shot to the stratosphere.
You know, it's not unusual for a price to get chased up by momentum players in retail and so on. So there's a lot of noise to it.
Even as TikTok clung to life in the United States. And moderate members of Congress offered a compromise approach to get that fourth round of stimulus that the White House said just might work.
If it provides a foundation where there's really a desire to do a deal, we're encouraged by that.
Even as Speaker Pelosi said, it never could.
We'll negotiate with the administration and the Republicans on this, not with ourselves.
So investors are left to pick their way gingerly through a minefield of uncertainty and risk and opportunity. And to help guide us through that minefield, we now have our virtual roundtable of not one but two contributors from Harvard, former Treasury Secretary of the Treasury. He is Larry Summers and former Federal Reserve Board Governor Dan Tarullo. So, Larry, let's start with you, where the Fed was the big news, I guess, of this week. They came out with their decision. It sounded pretty much like what they said they were going to do back in August with their new strategic strategy, and yet the markets didn't like it at all. What went wrong? It felt like a little bit of a temper tantrum.
Markets liked it for a while, then the markets didn't like it. Look, I don't think this is that complicated. The Fed's got its foot on the accelerator to the floor. The car's not going that fast. The Fed says it's going to keep its foot on the accelerator to the floor, but it also says that it's going to be looking around in case there are any accidents and be willing to change that. So people don't feel that great about the situation when things are going slowly with the accelerator to the floor. And that's kind of the reality that we're dealing with. I don't think it's within the gift of the Fed to cause our nation to be competent in testing people to control or control COVID. It's not within the gift of the Fed for people to find it in their hearts to respect their fellow citizens, regardless of race. And it's not within the capacity of the Fed to provide the fiscal stimulus that the economy needs. So the Fed's doing the best it can, but unfortunately, we live in a world where if it was ever true, it's not right now that the chairman of the Fed is the second most important person in Washington.
So, Dan, you served in the Federal Reserve. Do they have, to continue Larry's analogy, an effective speedometer? That is to say, insofar as they're saying, let's get the inflation rate up, we're willing to tolerate more than 2%, is there a speedometer that really tells them where inflation's going? Do they have a theory?
Well, no, there's no, there hasn't been a working theory of inflation for central banks for quite some time now. I mean, the flattening of Phillips curve, which occurred, obviously, some years ago, but the central banks have finally caught up to seeing that it is flat, means that there's really no way to be particularly predictive. And I think that's one of the reasons why the Fed was unanimous in shifting to an approach to monetary policy that looks more at actual inflation rather than predicted inflation based on expectations of where the unemployment rate is going to be going. You know, David, on the question you asked Larry a moment ago, I do think that there's a bunch of intra-market stuff going on here. I mean, if you look at what some of the market commentary said, the disappointment came because Chair Powell didn't go forward with giving some more indication of where quantitative easing would be. That sounded to me like a situation in which there were some financial actors who had certain positions which would have benefited from a little more specificity on QE than they got, but not very much to do with the real economy.
So, Larry, one of the things that I'm intrigued in is the extent to which the stock values have been driven by the discount factor. When you get down to zero or close to zero, theoretically, the value of stock could be infinite. Is that part of what's going on with tech, that people are figuring out that part of the value that's put into the stock of tech is actually because the interest rate's so low?
Yeah, I don't think there's any question that the longer lived a financial asset is, the more sensitive it is to interest rates. And if you're a growth company, you're a longer lived asset in terms of your future profits and your future cash flows than if you're a value company. And that explains a lot about the cleavages that we've seen in the stock market, along, of course, with the fact that various kinds of IT companies have seen their underlying businesses strengthen because people can't go to stores and can't go outside. So I think that's what's going on. But look, as Bob Rubin used to say during the Clinton administration, markets go up, markets go down, and they're going to be fluctuations and they're not going to be obvious causes for them. So I think it would be a mistake to be over-interpreting movements of a few percent over a few days. I think the deep truth about our moment is that the Fed doesn't have the capacity to predict inflation with great accuracy and doesn't have the capacity to control inflation with any great efficacy, given that it can't move interest rates down, and there's not much reason to want to move interest rates up. And so without the ability to predict or control inflation, the Fed becomes a bit more of a sideshow. And for people who have relied on the Fed to make their life work and to achieve what they want, that's a discouraging and perhaps even somewhat disillusioning thing. It doesn't mean that the Fed isn't doing the right thing. There are some underlying realities here that shape the situation.
So Dan, thus far, the markets have been fairly reassured by the Fed essentially giving an underpinning to the markets. Is there a risk here, a macroprudential risk, basically in having almost free money indefinitely?
Well, presumably over time there will be, which obviously counsels renewed attention to financial regulatory policy. Your viewers may have noticed that in the Fed's statement of longer term strategy, there was a paragraph about potential financial stability concerns. How that translates into Fed action, I think they've left substantially less clear. I mean, they're lean against using monetary policy itself as a way of restraining inflated assets, but they haven't made clear what, if anything, they're prepared to do with regulatory policy, which, by the way, probably isn't adequate to deal with the leverage and short-term financing that hedge funds and REITs and lots of other intermediaries can engage in. David, I just wanted to add something, or maybe put things in a slightly different way than Larry did a minute ago about the role of the Fed. I'm not sure I'd characterize it as a sideshow quite, because for a couple of reasons. One, as a liquidity provider and as a regulator, it's still quite important. And I also agree with what Larry was saying about the diminished capacity of the Fed to rectify the macroeconomic issues and problems that we've got. But I think where the Fed is almost inevitably headed is towards more of a de facto partnership with the Treasury Department, with the executive branch. That is, because of the dependence on fiscal policy to move us out of the situation we're going to be in for quite some time, because of the Fed's commitment to keeping rates low and thus keeping rates at the long end, presumably at the long end of the yield curve low, as well as at the short end, I think you're going to see almost inevitably an increasing amount of purchases of treasuries over time. And you're going to see the need for the Fed to think more closely about how it fits in with fiscal developments and debt issuance. Right. And under those circumstances, as I've described them, do not sound like the independent Fed that we've gotten used to since the early 50s when Treasury and the Fed agreed to break apart the cooperative arrangement they had had during the war.
And Larry, listen, maybe a truly independent Fed is not what we need right now, but whether it's dependent or independent, this de facto partnership isn't going to get us where we need to go with the economy overall. I mean, long before the COVID-19 hit, you were talking about secular stagnation. We had very modest growth. We did not have productivity growth. What do we need to get productivity growth going again and real fundamental growth going in the economy?
Dan and I are basically in agreement. You know, some of this has been in the making for a long time. If you thought about the early financial crisis years, every month or every 2 months, the Fed was proudly announcing that it was going to do quantitative easing, where it was going to issue short-term debt and buy long-term debt in order to stimulate the economy. And the Treasury Department every month was announcing that it was going to issue more long-term debt to lock in low rates for the benefit of taxpayers. And basically, they were trading with each other and making the broker-dealers rich. So the idea that we're going to have more coordination, I think, is overdue and welcome. And at a moment when we've got inflation below what we want, I'm not deeply worried about some sacred independence of the Fed. At all. I also agree with Dan that perhaps I should have said conventional monetary policy is a sideshow, because there certainly are important regulatory decisions. And if we have another panic, the Fed will certainly have a crucial role in dealing with that panic. I think with respect to regulation, David, the problem always is that we realize we should have regulated when we're in a mess and we need more credit, not less credit. And regulation will slow flow of credit. But I think the idea that Dodd-Frank had solved all the problems was never a very plausible idea. And I think that it was to Dan's great credit during his time at the Fed that he was always pushing to do more on regulation rather than, as many others were, to be complacent about what had been put in place. Look, David, to get the economy growing, we need to get COVID in the rearview mirror, which means we need extensive testing with fast reporting and action based on the results. Until we have that, or we have a vaccine, and I don't think a vaccine's gonna come that fast, we're not gonna have a rapidly growing economy. Once we have that, in order to really have a rapidly growing economy, we need much more public investment in virtually everything that we've had, whether it's infrastructure. Look, when I started flying from Boston to Washington, it took an hour and a quarter. Now it takes an hour and 45 minutes. That's not because jet engine technology has deteriorated, And it's not because Washington or Boston have moved. It's because of a deteriorating infrastructure in our country. And that's a small example of what's going on in everything from transportation to the quality of the laboratories in our schools to the way in which we produce electricity. We need investment in innovation and education and the right program of coherent investment in America's future.
Right.
Doesn't bust the deficit.
Right.
It sets the stage for future prosperity at a lower debt to GDP ratio.
Yep.
And until we embark on it, we're not going to get out of the current feeling.
All of which the markets may well understand. Thanks so much to former Federal Reserve Governor Dan Tarullo of Harvard. Coming up, Larry Summers will stay with us. This is Bloomberg Wall Street Week. I'm David Westin. For our lightning round of Summers Says this week, we put some odds-making questions to Larry. Starting, Larry, with what are the odds that we're going to dip back into a recession again in the next 18 months?
30%. It could happen, David, because COVID gets worse much quicker than we think. It could happen because of the withdrawal of fiscal stimulus prematurely. And it could happen because we have a series of aftershocks in terms of layoffs, in terms of problems in the banking sector. I don't think it will happen, but nobody should confuse the progress in reducing unemployment that we've had in the last few months with being anything other than a temporary kind of bounce back. It's going to be a slog from here. And when you're flying near stall speed, you often stall. So 30-35%.
Okay, so second question, somewhat related, not the same as, let's talk about the stock market. I know you're an economist, not a market predictor, but at the same time, what is the low point? Given the S&P where it is today, what's the low point over the next 18 months? How much will it lose, do you think, go down?
I think the market's probably going to be a little more volatile than it usually has been historically. And you'd kind of say that the market moves 15-20% in a year, and intra-year it can be a little worse. So my guess is that the low point over the next year to 18 months will be something like 20% below its current level.
Okay.
And that's not based on pessimism. That's just based on kind of what the it's somewhere near what the normal patterns are. Maybe maybe it'll be a bit better than that since the fluctuation could go in the other direction. But I'd be a bit surprised if markets don't touch at some point a level distinctly below where they are right now.
Okay, from markets, let's go to politics. What are the chances that we will know for certain who the president of the United States will be in the next term by December 15?
90%. It will be a disaster for the country if we don't, because if we don't know and we're in doubt for over a month, when the outcome comes, people aren't going to accept it the way Democratic supporters of Al Gore accepted the outcome in December of 2000. And it's going to be a real problem for our democracy. Fortunately, my guess is that the election will not end up being that tremendously close. And so I'd expect that this will get worked out well before December 15th. But even the 10% chance that I assign is really very scary.
Yeah, very scary. I would agree with that 100%. Okay, many thanks now to our special contributor, Larry Summers, for that special edition, actually, of Summers Says. Coming up, like all the rest of us, M&A has been hit hard by the pandemic. We talk with Evercore founder and senior chairman Roger Altman about whether we began to see a resurgence this week.
The freeze on M&A activity, which extended over about 3 months, is now being succeeded by a real thaw.
This is Wall Street Week on Bloomberg. This is Wall Street Week. I'm David Westin. The pandemic and the economic shutdown it triggered have taken a toll on mergers and acquisitions this year, with Bloomberg numbers showing them down by more than a third. But this week, we may have seen some resurgence with a series of big deals, including Gilead and Nvidia. Roger Altman, founder and senior chairman of Evercore, thinks this could mark the beginning of a turnaround.
I think a recovery is underway. I'm not smart enough to know how fast this recovery will occur, but generally speaking, the freeze that we saw after the virus erupted and the lockdowns took place, beginning really in mid-March, the freeze on M&A activity, which extended over about 3 months, is now being succeeded by a real thaw. And I think it remains to be seen just how robust this recovery will be, but we're definitely seeing a recovery.
Roger, if it's fair to ask it this way, to what extent, if there is a thaw, is it offensive versus defensive? By that I mean, is this because CEOs, companies are seeing great new opportunities in growth that they want to take advantage of? Or is it because some companies are under such stress that they need to consolidate?
I think it's primarily offensive, at least when it comes to large combinations. So I think at least when it comes to the really large ones, they're more offensive than they are defensive.
To what extent is the Federal Reserve helping this process, or hurting it for that matter? Because we have money that's, if it's not free, it's pretty darn close to free.
The Fed played the central role in allowing the financial markets to ease. And of course, they're in really good shape now, very good shape, and the economy to begin to recover. So I take my hat off to the Fed. It's done a straight A job. It's not hindering anything. Without the Fed, we'd be in a bad place. And I'm not commenting on M&A. I'm talking about America.
But at the same time, is it driven prices up, asset prices up? If you're looking to buy something, is it more expensive?
Well, before the virus erupted, interest rates were very low by historical standards. Very low. So the impact of ultra-low interest rates and abundant credit availability on valuations, that impact was in place before the intervention I'm talking about. But anyway, that's not a new development.
That was Roger Altman, founder and senior chairman of Evercore. Coming up, the battle over TikTok. What's at stake, and what is the fight really about? From someone who has done big, complicated tech deals with China, Sam Palmisano, former CEO of IBM.
If you can solve the issues around personal data and the uses of personal data and protect people's privacy, that could be resolved. But you still need government approval on both sides.
This is Wall Street Week on Bloomberg. Time is running out on the tug of war over TikTok. Oracle beat out Microsoft in its bid for some sort of deal for TikTok's U.S. operations, but it's not over yet. The deal still has to pass muster with the U.S. government, including President Trump's personal approval. And he says he's none too pleased with what he's seen.
I'm not prepared to sign off on anything. I have to see the deal. We need security, especially after what we've seen with respect to China and what's going on. We want security.
Under the proposed deal, Oracle would be the U.S. technology partner of TikTok and gain control over the personal data of U.S. users, but leave Beijing-based ByteDance with a majority ownership stake.
we are now moving into a much more multipolar tech world, where the tech companies from China aren't only doing services for China.
In its lawsuit against the U.S. government, TikTok says it has more than 100 million monthly active users in the United States, a growth of nearly 800% since January 2018.
They're unique because they rose to a lot of usage very, very quickly. They also come from China, which has been unusual because the other competitors are mostly U.S. or European companies.
The administration has raised national security concerns about TikTok's U.S. operations because of the access it has to personal data about tens of millions of U.S. citizens and the possibility of using the social media app to deliver disinformation to U.S. users.
We don't want detailed personal information on all of our teenage children who are the main users of TikTok to become part of a big Chinese database to use to infiltrate our country.
President Trump first zeroed in on TikTok in July when he suggested an outright ban on the app as a way of punishing China, and then followed up a few weeks later with an executive order setting a 90-day deadline for ByteDance to sell or spin off its U.S. business.
Yes, I think we have to be very concerned about security and data privacy, but China has also banned virtually every American digital platform in China, so the playing field is not level.
There aren't that many U.S. executives who've done big, complicated tech deals with China, but Wall Street Week contributor Sam Palmisano is one of the few who sold his PC business to Lenovo when he was CEO of IBM.
We had a period in time where there were better relations between the two countries, China and the United States. And China was also in a different phase of their growth strategy, and they were inclined to create global businesses that could be housed in China that could expand beyond their domestic market. So the circumstances were quite different than they are today. Having said that, it's an extremely complicated process. It's run by Treasury. That's a fair process. They make a recommendation to the President of the United States for approval. But normally, at least in our case in the process, it becomes political. In that case, basically because we were selling an asset that we believed was just going to be commoditized. There was not a lot of technical differentiation in a PC, as you see today. But fundamentally, various parties on the Hill got engaged, and it made it complicated, which meant we had to go through a second review, which prolonged everything, which puts the deal in jeopardy. As you know, they say time kills deals. But fundamentally, we hung in there, and we got approval from both governments, and we proceeded.
Yeah, and it's clear, nothing else is clear. It's clear that whatever TikTok has is not commoditized, to use your word, whether it's the algorithms being used or the data, the personal data, which seem to be the real centerpiece of the concern over national security. And therefore, this deal is more complicated. How you really protect those data, is that the big sticking point as far as you can tell?
I think it is. You know, I really do think it's a combination of the algorithms and the personal data. And it's the amount of the personal data, and that's called the usage of the personal data. Now, there's solutions that could be had other than shutting people down and those sorts of things. And I really do think that there's a pragmatic solution on the table that perhaps both governments could approve that would at least take one issue off the table in the U.S.-China relations. And let me explain what I mean by that. The current, what I read anyway, like you, we only know it's been reported, is that ByteDance would maintain majority share of TikTok, but they would create a global entity that would be housed in the United States. Oracle would be a technology partner and provide that infrastructure, i.e. cloud, et cetera, which makes sense for Oracle. And maybe by doing this sort of thing, if you can solve the issues around personal data and the uses of personal data and protect people's privacy, that could be resolved. But you still need government approval on both sides. And the Chinese also have the equivalent of CFIUS in their process as well.
Yeah, it's clear that the Chinese have a dog in this fight, without a doubt. But is it possible from your experience for the U.S. government to really be assured that those personal data cannot go back to the Chinese government? Because I think that was the thing they were concerned about, right?
Well, absolutely. And basically, you know, the complicated thing here, we don't have any of the details. Let's start with the structure itself, the majority owner being ByteDance, is obviously a Chinese company. What's the governance model? Who's on the board of it? How's the entity operate? Are they a passive investor? I mean, I can go on and on and on. Is it a financial deal or is it an operational deal? If it's an operational deal, it becomes more complicated. Now, as far as protecting the data that exists, if it's all housed in the United States, it's somewhat easier. But nonetheless, I mean, information is going to be flowing across the world. So you're always going to run the risk of any nation or really any hacker being able to get into that kind of an infrastructure. Now, having said that, I mean, I think a partner like Oracle or an IBM, enterprise tech companies who have a lot of experience of protecting data, they do this for themselves and for large enterprises, is probably a better partner than, let's say, your traditional consumer tech company might be able to provide.
Well, that's exactly my question, Sam, because I don't think of Oracle as being a consumer-facing tech business, unlike a Microsoft or unlike a Google or a Facebook. Why does this make sense strategically for Oracle?
Oh, I think if you think about cloud, the emerging architecture for computing in the future, Oracle is way behind, as is IBM and many of the other traditional enterprise players. And the leaders, as we all know, are Amazon, and catching up is Microsoft. So to them, it gives them, I think, an entry point with a very large social media company into the infrastructure. I think will give them credibility in the cloud and moving into the future. So from that perspective, strategically, that makes a heck of a lot of sense. They're going to be a minority investor. It's almost like an outsourcing deal in the sense that you operate people's assets for them, but you acquire those assets, and the acquisition of those assets will be an equity. Again, only as I've read, so I don't have any insight to that. So, you know, they'll make an investment. They'll get the outsourcing of the infrastructure that will be housed in the United States, and that will create jobs. I don't know if it's 25,000 or not. I mean, the only reason why 25,000 to me sounds like a large number is because Facebook, as big as they are, only has 75,000 employees.
Well, and finally, Sam, what if, in fact, it does not get approved? If in the end, President Trump says, I don't like this, what does that mean, maybe for Oracle, but more importantly, for ByteDance?
Well, I think at the end of the day, I mean, will they shut them down? I don't know. You know, I think, quite honestly, there are ways to solve these problems. There are national security concerns. I can understand that. It's really the bigger issue is protecting people's personal information.
That was Wall Street Week contributor Sam Palmisano. Coming up, as climate change brings conflagration to California and Oregon, one of Wall Street's most respected leaders says there are ways to use the markets to address one of the most pressing issues of our age. Former head of Goldman Sachs and Treasury Secretary Hank Paulson.
The private sector can do its part, but without a change in government policies, the private sector is not going to be able to take care of it.
This is Wall Street Week on Bloomberg.
Let us not forget one fundamental issue which lies at the heart of our problems. Over a period of years, persistent and growing global imbalances fueled a dramatic increase in capital flows, low interest rates, excessive risk-taking, and a global search for return. These excesses cannot be attributed to any single nation.
That was Hank Paulson speaking as Treasury Secretary back at the height of the financial crisis in 2008. Hank has now moved on to another crisis, one that he sees as potentially much, much greater than the downturn 12 years ago. It's what he calls the dramatic extinction episode we're experiencing and the threat to the biodiversity of the planet. But given his experience, it's no surprise that he thinks the markets themselves can and should be brought to bear. And with the help of government, turn things around by making biodiversity itself investable.
There's an alarming destruction of biodiversity, forests, wetlands, prairies around the world. And as you said, a staggering extinction episode, which I think has really grave implications for humanity in terms of prosperity and the well-being of people on Earth. Now, we're just in, and to put some parameters around this extinction episode, that it's playing out at 1,000 times the normal level, which means that rather than losing 1 to 5 species a year, we're losing a lot. And, you know, if this continues unabated, we'd lose, you know, half of the animals and plants on Earth by mid-century. And you know, this would have an enormous economic impact. Now, we're just in the early stage, and, you know, scientists and economists are in the very early stage of being able to quantify and measure the magnitude of what this means economically. But one thing we know for sure, the best way to hedge against these risks is to invest in nature. And the problem we've had for some time is our economic systems don't really measure nature. They don't account for the value of the services provided by the natural world. And that's because we have market failures. These services and nature is treated as a free good. And so that means that that those who invest in it aren't to conserve it aren't appropriately rewarded. Those who destroy it aren't appropriately penalized.
Can the markets take care of this on their own? We now have a lot of ESG funds. BlackRock's got a big one. Various people have big. So Goldman Sachs, by the way, you may have heard of them. They have one as well. Could the private sector by itself take care of this?
No, no way. As a matter of fact, one of the findings, you know, which is very clearly, was that the private sector can do its part, but without a change in government policies, the private sector is not going to be able to take care of it. And, you know, one of the things that's been clear to me over many years in terms of advocating for conservation, you need to get government to act, and government's not going to act without broad public support, broad business support. And to do that, you need to make the economic case. And the private sector has a lot of money that can flow into this area, but the government has to create the conditions for that capital to come in, has to create the proper incentives and financing mechanisms. So we lay out a number of those mechanisms or change the subsidies. Or the other, I think one thing that the private sector could do that wouldn't cost a lot, it would make a big difference, and that we talk about in the report, it is a different approach looking at the risks in the financial sector around investing and lending. And if banks throughout the world had screens, you know, environmental protection screens, looking at the practices and principles and risks, and avoided funding harmful projects and infrastructure projects and doing and making sure there's planning done in advance, this would make a big difference. This would make a huge difference.
Is it particularly difficult to make that economic case right now when we do have something of a global recession? We don't know, I think, where we are. Where do you think we are in terms of the strength of the economy domestically as well as around the world? Can we sustain the sort of investment you're talking about?
Okay, so I'm going to make 2 points. In terms of where we are, this is a very serious challenge, much more significant than what we faced during the 2008 financial crisis, because we're dealing with a disease plus the economic impact. And a lot of your question is going to be determined by our ability to control the disease, no doubt about it. But I think the government came in very early, and I was very pleased with the leadership from Steven Mnuchin working with members of Congress on both sides of the aisle to come up with a very expansive, you know, fiscal program, a stimulus program. I was very pleased with what you saw out of the Federal Reserve. We staved off disaster. More needs to be done.
Can this be addressed without the two largest economies coming together, that is U.S. and China? Because right now we seem to be at loggerheads with China. You know China terribly well. Is there any possibility of a rapprochement that could help us address issues like this together?
Now, in terms of your question about the U.S. and China, you know, this is a very difficult relationship right now. And, you know, it's escalating downward at a dangerous rate. We're dealing with a very different China right now. The views toward China have really hardened among Republicans and Democrats, much, much tougher on China. And I think they need to be, but we need to be smart about what we do. And we need to make sure that while we identify the areas where we have differences with China, where there are conflicts. We figure out how to deal with those and how to manage those while not precluding the opportunity and the need to work together to solve global problems.
That was former Treasury Secretary Hank Paulson. Coming up, we wrap up the week in markets with Katie Nixon of Northern Trust. This is Wall Street Week on Bloomberg. This is Bloomberg Wall Street Week. I'm David Westin. Well, whatever the equity markets wanted to hear from the Fed this week, they certainly didn't get it, as the S&P fell for the third week in a row, and tech stocks ended up at their lowest level in 6 weeks. To guide us through the market's maze, we welcome now Katie Nixon, Northern Trust Management Chief Investment Officer. So guide us through this maze, Katie. What happened this week exactly? Were the markets really that disappointed with what the Fed had to say? It basically said what it said it was going to say, didn't it?
Yes, I don't think the market necessarily was disappointed in what the Fed had to say as a driving force behind the volatility. I think it's a confluence of things, David. I mean, we are in a period of time in the calendar year, which is typically a little bit tough for stocks in general. And then we've got all of these cross currents of news on the pandemic, some of it not so great. So I think markets are in this digestion phase of figuring out what's next. And I think the situation in the picture looks a little bit murky at this point.
Well, let's talk about that combination, actually. On the one hand, is it sort of falling out of love a little bit with tech, saying, oh, we've gone far enough with that, we need to go back to cycles? And by the way, you mentioned the pandemic. Are people saying maybe we're a little more hopeful about vaccines or something coming out the pandemic that will get us past this?
Right. Of course, the news on the vaccines has generally been really positive. I think the timing, though, still remains a question. We know it's going to be a when, not if kind of scenario, but whether it's in the first quarter, whether it might get pushed to the second quarter, that means something to the markets. Now, in terms of the rotation, there does feel like there's a desire to really rotate out of the mega growth stocks and more into value stocks, but it's tentative. We didn't see a massive outperformance over the last couple of days. It kind of felt more tentative to me. So I think unless we have real visibility into the economic future, which is really going to depend on the pandemic, it's going to be hard to have a real durable rotation out of growth and into value. I think the tech stocks, frankly, are just due for a correction. And that's what we're seeing as investors are taking some chips off the table here and booking some really nice profits.
Well, it's nice to take the profits. The question is, what do you do with those profits? And if you're really putting together a portfolio right now, what do you do? Historically, you'd say, well, let's put 40% into bonds. But at this point, you can't get the yields much lower than they are right now, so the bonds can't go too much higher. So where do you go to really hedge?
I mean, unfortunately, there's no great answer to that question. There's no satisfactory answer, I should say. The fact is, we still think cash and bonds provide a hedge to portfolios. The problem is you're not going to get much return. So it feels in a lot of ways like a relatively expensive insurance policy. So what we're advising our clients and what I would advise all investors to do is just make sure your bond portfolio is right-sized. Don't be over-allocated to fixed income right now because, as you rightly referenced, the upside from here is very limited, to say the least. But you do need fixed income and cash to provide you that buffer to fund goals, near-term high-value goals that you may have over the next couple of weeks and months. But you don't want to have too much in fixed income.
Okay, so does that push you out sort of, if I can call it, the risk curve a little bit? Say, let's take some more risky bets here because we got to put it somewhere and we want some sort of return. It's hard to get it from fixed income, and maybe we don't believe equities will be at least a steady return going forward.
Well, I mean, you have to have the right time horizon, David. So if you're invested in equities, you've got to have a long-term time horizon, especially given the headwinds that we see over the next couple of weeks and months. You know, we have, in addition to the bobbling news about the pandemic, whether it's positive news on the vaccine front, perhaps negated somewhat with rising case counts, certainly in Europe and even in the U.S. to a certain extent. So, you know, we have that near-term volatility. We have the election, clearly, which is going to drive a lot of market volatility. So if you're invested in equities, you got to have a long-term perspective. One area, though, that we continue to see value is in high yield. So you're creeping out on the risk spectrum, certainly, and we consider high yield to be a risk asset and not a risk control asset. But that said, you're still getting, you know, a 5% kind of return. And we think that default rates actually are going to be falling into 2021 and beyond. So it's not a bad return relative to what else is out there right now.
You mentioned the election. How do you play the election as a practical matter? We're starting to see it in some actually parts of the market that people are really starting to price in at least increased volatility, particularly if we don't get a firm answer on November 3rd, which at this point seems very questionable.
Oh, I think we have to, we absolutely have to expect that we won't get an answer on election night as we're used to. The very high volume of mail-in and absentee voting is going to make that an impossibility. So I think we have to be prepared. We have to be prepared to withstand perhaps an extended period of excessive market volatility to the extent that we have an undecided or even a contested election. Now, we've been there in the past, and we know that markets don't like uncertainty. And so we see that markets do sell off in the face of that kind of uncertainty. And we have to expect that, which, again, kind of comes right back to your original question about bonds, cash and bonds and portfolios. That's really why you want to own cash and bonds, because we do think that that will provide you a great diversification benefit in the event that we do have some volatility coming into and then post the election period.
Katie, in a word or two, are your clients, are investors being reasonably patient right now, or are they very angsty?
Well, I think investors are being patient, but I do think that there's growing anxiety around the election, David. You know, right. Investors are very concerned right. about how this will break right. from a tax perspective, a regulatory right. perspective. Right. You were just talking okay. about China earlier. So there's a lot Katie, at play right now.
Katie, many, many thanks. Great to have you here. That's Katie Nixon of Northern Trust. Finally, one more thought. Hail to the victors valiant. This week, there may have been a lot going on in markets and the business world and Washington, but for fans of college football, or at least for some of us, the lead of the week was the return of the Big Ten to playing football, something that certainly caught the attention of the fan-in-chief in the White House.
I want to congratulate Big Ten football. It's back. And I want to, in particular, I've been dealing with him, thank Commissioner Kevin Warren for the great job he did. We've been working with him for a while.
Sure, we may not be able to have as many fans in the stands, or maybe not any at all. Sure, we may be able to play only within the conference, and it will be a much shorter season. But despite all that's different, there will be some return to what has been and what should be. And doesn't that feel just a little bit like a victory over this cursed virus that has taken so much from us? So I'm happy for the Big Ten, and maybe even for the Buckeyes of Ohio State, maybe. But come the big game, the one that really matters, go Blue. That does it for this episode of Wall Street Week. I'm David Westin. This is Bloomberg. See you next week.